Hello, and welcome to a presentation on STEMI recognition. I'm going to provide some tips and tricks that hopefully you will find helpful in recognizing myocardial infarctions on a 12-lead EKG. So I think most paramedics out there would be able to recognize the STEMI here, right? This is an obvious anteroseptal wall myocardial infarction. All right, this is an LAD occlusion. You have ST elevation that is pretty significant here in the anterior anteroseptal lead. So V2 is really obvious, V3, even V4 has elevation, and you have reciprocal changes in V5 and V6, and over here in the inferior leads as well. And then you have lateral, high lateral wall extension as well. So it's actually anteroseptal, anterolateral wall MI. Big LAD occlusion is most likely, and I like to say that these anterior MIs, anything involving the LAD, those patients die fast. So this would be the patient that you would be ready to resuscitate because those are the ones that go into VFib. So we say that those patients die fast. They will out of nowhere decompensate and be ready to shock them and provide resuscitation. But what about this patient? So this is a 48-year-old male with dyspnea and chest pain. Now, be honest, if you were interpreting this 12-lead, in the field, and you had this 48-year-old male patient in front of you, would you call STEMI alert based on this 12-lead alone? If you look at it, you might see that there really isn't any impressive ST segment elevation. You might have some in V2 and in V3, right? Maybe just at 2 millimeters of elevation here in V2, but you really need that 2 millimeters of elevation over in these leads, V2, V3. Because it's normal to have some degree of elevation there. So it would be fine not to call this a STEMI alert. However, this is an early MI. This is an anterior wall MI. And it's because of these T waves. These are hyperacute T waves. What does that mean? So early in an MI, when you're having that ischemic tissue, you'll get these tall, symmetrical T waves that you see in V2, pretty tall, V3, V4, even a little bit in V5, you get these tall symmetrical T waves. Symmetrical just means that they're mirrored left and right. They make almost a perfect isosceles triangle if you were to draw a line across the bottom. So you see that, and those T waves show up where the infarct is going to occur, where it is occurring, really. So they have an LAD occlusion. This is just an early sign of that LAD occlusion. You don't yet arguably have STEMI alert criteria. So you wouldn't necessarily call STEMI alert, but do everything else the same. Transmit the 12 lead, go to PCI center, and treat this patient as if they're having an active anterior wall MI. The other way to know is if you start to develop reciprocal changes such as ST depression. Now, the anterior leads truly don't have reciprocal leads on a traditional 12 lead. These reciprocal changes, you know, that you're seeing over in the inferior leads are likely an early indication of lateral wall extension. So just like that 12 lead we were just looking at that had an anteroseptal lateral extension, this one will likely have that as well. And it did with the subsequent 12 lead. So hyperacute T waves are these tall, symmetrical T waves, a little bit more obvious on this one. And you can see that they are starting to have some elevation here as well. So if you see those tall T waves that are symmetrical, especially if they're broad-based like these, they're not hyperkalemic T waves, they're hyperacute T waves. And consider the company that it keeps, right? Every 12 lead comes with a patient. So if your patient's presenting like somebody having cardiac symptoms, along with a 12 lead that looks like this, start treating them, even if it doesn't say STEMI, even if it doesn't have the elevation, start treating them like they are a STEMI. Just don't call the STEMI alert. Transmit the 12 lead. Start providing those treatments and get them transported to the correct facility. Here's another example of hyperacute T waves. Again, these are broad-based, they're tall, they're very symmetrical. And it's common to see these in these anteroseptal leads and just the anterior leads as a whole, all the way to the lateral wall here. But you can see them sometimes in the inferior leads if they're having an inferior wall MI. But I just wanted to drive home this pattern of this anteroseptal wall MI, this LAD occlusion patient. Again, remember, these are the ones that die fast. So you want to be ready to treat these patients. Here's another example. And these T waves, the height kind of stands out because the QRSs aren't as big. and you still get nice, big, tall, symmetrical T waves before the elevation occurs. All right, so this is early in the MI, which is good in a sense. Like the earlier you identify an MI and treat them correctly, the more myocardium, the more heart muscle you're going to save. And that's the whole idea here, is to keep that tissue from becoming necrotic, which is irreversible damage. We want to get as much of that myocardium saved as possible. Here's another example of hyperacute T waves. These are a little bit narrower, so they almost look like hyperkalemic T waves here, but coupled with that ST depression, these are actually something called De Winter's T waves. You don't have to remember that, but De Winter's T waves are J-point depression with the hyperacute T waves, especially in these anterior leads, V2, V3 anteroseptal leads. And they are a pretty good indication. It's a STEMI equivalent, really, that they're going to have a significant MI if they're not already having it. All right, let's talk about the next type of EKG changes. Here's a 22-year-old male with chest pain. It's kind of juxtaposing this to the last one we saw on purpose. So we do see elevation on this 12 lead. Hopefully you can see some elevation in lead one, you have some elevation. Lead two, you have some elevation. V2, V3, V5, V6. So not every lead has elevation, but most of them on this 12 lead has some degree of J point or ST segment elevation, which should clue you into a few things, right? So if you see elevation in two leads that do not correspond with each other, as you do whenever you see elevation in leads one and two, those leads are more reciprocal to each other. They're not looking at the same area of myocardium. And you have a patient that fits. Every 12 lead comes with a patient, right? So this is a 22-year-old male with chest pain. 22-year-old males, while it's possible that they could have a myocardial infarction, it's very unlikely. It's much more likely that there's something more benign, less concerning, less occlusive going on. And what's happening here is acute pericarditis. So this patient is experiencing acute pericarditis, which you've probably heard causes global ST segment elevation. It's global in a sense that it is in leads that do not correspond with each other. It doesn't have to be in every single lead. You'll always see a reciprocal type of ST depression in AVR. Other than that, you should never see reciprocal changes with acute pericarditis. So the other leads should not have reciprocal changes. For the most part, it should be a concave. So the U-shaped type of ST elevation, not the convex, which is more tombstone-like. If it's tombstone-like, that's more likely an MI. You might see PR segment depression. All right, that's more common with viral pericarditis. And then something called spotic sign. Spotic sign is how you get this downward line from the J point all the way down into the TP segment and then down into the PR segment until you get to the next QRS. And then it comes back up and then it starts going down again. So this downsloping line is called spotic sign. That's a slight indication of acute pericarditis as well. So you take everything into account, the patient presentation being one of the biggest ones, right? They often present with positional-like pain. They have other signs of inflammation because it's an itis, right? They have their immune system is responding to something. They probably have an infection of their pericardium. And that's what pericarditis is. It's inflamed from that, and it's causing the constrictive pericarditis, causing these ST segment changes. That's what you're seeing. Here's another example of acute pericarditis here. Again, you have the concave ST elevation and a whole lot of leads on this 12-lead EKG. You do have that spotic sign, that downsloping from the J point into the TP segment all the way to the next QRS complex. And it's elevation in leads that do not correspond with each other and no true reciprocal changes. Again, you may see a little bit in AVR. And V1 tends to do what AVR does. They both have very similar vectors and looking at the 12 lead. So you'll see an inverted T wave often in V1 and maybe a slight J point depression, but every other lead should not have any ST segment depression. Here's another example of acute pericarditis. The other thing is it looks a lot like early repolarization. And what do I mean by that? Well, a lot of you may have learned about this notched J point with early repolarization. Acute pericarditis is an early repolarization pattern. If all you had was the 12 lead, you wouldn't be able to determine that this is acute pericarditis versus early repolarization. It's the same look, the same thing. It's just the patient presentation that helps you figure out which one is which. Now look at this 12 lead. Here's another one that should be pretty obvious for you paramedics out there. This 12-lead is an obvious inferoposterior wall MI. So it's an inferior wall MI and a posterior wall MI because this patient has what's called a dominant RCA occlusion. Well, what does that mean? The right coronary artery, the RCA, in most people, like over 85% of people, it's like 85 to 90% of people, their posterior descending artery, the coronary artery in the back of the heart that provides blood flow to the posterior wall of the heart, that comes from, it's derived from the right coronary artery. So the right coronary artery wraps around, provides blood flow to that posterior descending artery. And the other very small percentage of people, it comes from the left circumflex. So it's possible to have a lateral posterior wall MI. And that's how you would know it's a more of a left circumflex occlusion. When you see an inferior posterior wall MI, you assume it's a dominant RCA occlusion. So you could have a dominant left circumflex or a dominant RCA. Most people have a dominant RCA. Why am I telling you all that? Well, it's very, very common to see both the inferior wall changes here, where you see ST segment elevation and 2-3 AVF. Remember, all three of those leads are looking up at the heart from the bottom. So it's the bottom of the heart, which is mostly the right ventricle. Another quick check here. If you have more elevation in lead three than in lead two, it is a right-sided MI. The right ventricle is involved, right? That's simply because lead three sits more to the patient's right than lead two. Now, looking up at V1 and V2, you see ST segment depression. Well, these leads are not reciprocal to the inferior wall. These are the septal leads. They are reciprocal to the posterior wall. So if we did a posterior 12 lead, we would likely see elevation in those posterior leads. What's reciprocal to the inferior wall is AVL. Whenever you see ST elevation in any of the inferior leads, most likely lead three, right? Coupled with ST depression and AVL, it's a STEMI. You don't need to do anything else. That is a STEMI. But you often will see the reciprocal changes over here in V1 through V3 as well, and that's the posterior wall. Now let's look at this 67-year-old female with dyspnea and pallor. All right, if you look at this 12 lead, would you assume this patient is having an MI? The dyspnea and the pallor, 67-year-old female, she's postmenopausal. It's very common for women especially to have atypical MIs, meaning no chest pain, and dyspnea is an angina equivalent. So look at dyspnea or shortness of breath and unexplained sweating or diaphoresis as an angina equivalent, meaning it's the same thing as chest pain. So treat those patients as if they're having chest pain and you won't miss some of these more occult STEMIs. This is not a STEMI. It doesn't have ST elevation. However, it is an MI. This patient is experiencing an early inferior wall myocardial infarction. And you're asked, well, how do you know based on this, right? It's AVL. So AVL, that look in AVL, that slight, not even half a millimeter of J-point depression, and then the way it dives into an inverted T-wave is an early reciprocal change. So the next thing that's going to happen is this is going to get deeper, and then these leads will start to elevate, probably lead three first. You also have a very flat V2 with a tall R-wave, all right? You shouldn't have a tall R-wave in V2. That's called early R-wave progression. All right, so your precordial axis, your V lead axis, has rotated. Why? Because this is a posterior Q wave. Again, these leads, right, are reciprocal, V1 and V2 are reciprocal to the posterior wall. So if you flip them, this becomes a Q wave, and this flat ST segment, it stays flat. Mostly in V2, you're used to seeing a little bit of like a diffuse J point into a curved up, almost how, you know, V3 looks. It looks more like that usually. But this is flat, almost depressed, and it will depress because it's a posterior infarction. So that is an early inferior wall MI. And I'll show you some more examples here. So that's the indication is AVL. Here's another one. Now this one, you have the hyperacute T waves we talked about in the inferior leads. So we saw it a lot in those anterior leads. Now you see it in the inferior leads. Big, tall T waves, they're symmetrical, broad-based. What's going on here? Look at AVL. Oh, this is an early inferior wall MI. Look at V2. V2, you have a little bit of that T-wave inversion starting, that J-point's going to start to depress, so you'll have the posterior wall changes as well. So this is an early inferior LMI, which is an RCA occlusion. Now, to make a point here, I said anterior LMIs, they die fast. Your inferior LMIs die slow. Why? And what do I mean by that? Well, look at this patient's heart rate, first of all. One of the things that happens often with inferior LMI is because our conduction system kind of starts in the right atrium, and a lot of the blood flow for both the SA node and the AV node comes from that RCA, right coronary artery. If you have a proximal RCA occlusion, it's going to affect conduction, and it often will cause AV blocks or bradycardias. So these patients will brady out and die on you, where your anterior LMIs will often go into V-fib unexpectedly. So I say the inferior LMIs die slow, your anterior LMIs die fast. Be ready to have your pads out and have it on both of them in an attempt to resuscitate early on if you need to. Here's another example of the early inferior wall MI. Again, AVL has that weird looking downsloping ST segment into the inverted T wave. And again, you have that flat ST segment in V2. Now, am I calling a STEMI alert here? Not really. I mean, I might have just enough ST elevation in lead 3 in AVF, but that's debatable. I'm probably going to transmit this, still go lights and sirens to the PCI facility if my patient's presentation, of course, fits cardiac symptom, and do serial 12 leads. Because I'm telling you this is an early finding, both with the hyperacute T waves and with this AVL finding for the inferior LMI, do serial 12 leads. Do a 12 lead as often as you do vitals, if not more often than you do vitals. And you'll see dynamic changes. And dynamic changes are just as good as ST segment elevation. If you see the ST segment change, like start to get bigger, you don't wait for 1 millimeter or 2 millimeters. That's enough. You know, you're seeing that MI occur right in front of your eyes. Here's an inferior posterior wall MI that's really early. Now this one, if you did a posterior 12 lead on, you might actually have, and this is the only indication really to do a posterior 12 lead, you might actually have enough elevation in those posterior leads to call STEMI alert just based on that alone, right? And I said V1 and V2 are reciprocal to the posterior wall. Really, you could see reciprocal changes all the way from V1 through V4. It depends on how big that posterior wall infarction is, and then that's how many leads you'll see it from reciprocally, that is a word. So you would, to do that posterior 12 lead, you'd simply take V4, V5, and V6, wrap those around to the back. You put them in the posterior axillary line, the posterior scapular line, and then, or like mid-scapular, and then just paraspinal, kind of following the same plane as V6, like that same height, if you will, as you go around to the back. And what's nice is those would become V7, V8, and V9, and you'd see the elevation right next to the reciprocal change because you're not changing V1, V2, V3. Which would be a nice clear 12 lead that kind of shows you everything you need to know to call that STEMI alert. That's all I got for you. I hope you enjoyed this presentation. Hopefully I was able to teach you a thing or two about, 12 lead interpretation. If not, good on you for knowing that stuff, and make sure you're sharing it with your partners out there and your coworkers. All right, have a good day.